and away we go, and away we go. Today is a very significant day, July 21st, 2015, and a year from now, we will not, probably not even recognize this world very much, the changes that are coming. So we want to complete our consideration by June 21st. So there's this 1 month period between June 21st and July 21st that it's kind of this final transitional time. We want to be done by June 21st as far as our considerations go. So we're right on track, and fortunately so. The breakthroughs keep happening. I'm doing everything I can to roll out this information. It's not easy. It's easy, but there's very little response. So let's put it that way. it's not difficult. What we need to emphasize is, I said before, Jesus is already back. What is Jesus? Jesus is Spirit of Truth. Spirit of Truth. It's just our one spirit. Reminding us that we are that one spirit also. Now, we have said, and we'll say it again, that this world, what is this world? We can get even a clear picture of it. What is this world? This world is like the after effects, the apparent after effects, the imaginary after effects of spirit committing imaginary suicide. Let's put it that way. Spirit has pretended to commit suicide. And this world embodies all this. It is the pretend after effects of the pretend suicide that spirit is imagining. So spirit can point to this world, bodies, and say, this is it. And then show. Now, why is spirit doing this? It wants to show this to guilt. Now, what is guilt? Guilt is the pretend after effects of spirit changing the will of God, which would kill God. God would no longer be God. So guilt is the imaginary after effect of spirit changing God. Spirit's just imagining that this happened. And then this world embodies. This is the imaginary after effect of spirit pretending to commit suicide. So that then spirit can show this world and bodies to guilt, and guilt will look at this and say, wow, yeah, spirit's no longer here. Spirit died. Spirit died. And then spirit imagines that this death of spirit, it's imaginary death, but it imagines that this imaginary death will placate the imaginary guilt, and guilt will say, oh, I got my victim. So the accounts are now settled, and I have no more claim to make. And then spirit will say, oh, great, okay, now I'm free of guilt. So I changed the will of God, but I had this after effect of that, but I got rid of the after effect by staging this pretend spiritual suicide. And now I'm free of guilt, so I'm now greater than God, and I'm free of guilt, and I'm free of all this. This is what's actually happening. This aliveness that we think we have in as bodies, this is just the imagined after effect of spiritual suicide, actually. It's not life at all. It's aliveness, which is battling against death, right? Trying to maintain this aliveness, trying not to be snuffed out by death, trying not to be hurt, trying not to get accidents, trying not to, you know, we're trying to get make sure we get our next breath. That's called aliveness. So we can say, I've never been alive. If you want to make a spiritual assertion, here's one to make. You say, I have never been alive. I've always been free. This is exactly where I want to be. I have never been alive. I've always been free. This is exactly where I've always wanted to be. Okay, I have never been alive. I've always been free. And this is exactly what I want to be. Put it that way. I've never been alive. I've always been free. This is exactly what I really want to be. I've never been alive. I've always been free. This is exactly what I really want to be. This is exactly what I really want to be. This is where I am now. This is where I am now. So I've never been alive. I've always been free. This is where I always really wanted to be. This is where I've always really wanted to be. Right? We don't want aliveness. We don't want to be alive. We've never been alive. This so-called being alive is merely the after effects, the result of what we believe to be a spiritual suicide. It's the evidence that we're presenting to imaginary guilt. Imaginary evidence being presented to imaginary guilt that, look, spirit really did commit suicide and die. And here's the evidence. Yeah, we have this aliveness, but the aliveness is now subject to death. You see? Everything in this world is subject to death, right? So how could it be of spirit? So it seems to be very convincing evidence, except it's all a dream. How convincing is any evidence in a dream? How convincing? In ordinary dreams. Now, sometimes spirit of truth comes into dreams and says, hey, this is all a dream, and nothing in a dream is convincing. Well, that would be, you know, something that is really appearing in a dream, but not of the dream. In the world, but not of it. In the dream, but not of it. Like Jesus, in the world, but not of it. Jesus comes back and he says, I've never been alive. I've always been free. I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. I've never been alive, meaning I've never been a body. I've never been a body. I am not a body. I am free. I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. I've never been alive. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. He who would seek to gain his life will lose it, and he who loses life, set down his life for my sake, will gain eternal life. Okay, what does this mean? This is what Jesus said. Of course, he who would seek to gain his life, mean he who would identify with this aliveness of the body, which is really just being imagined as the after effect, the result of spirit committing suicide. So he who would identify that with that body will surely die, because the purpose of the dream is to show that now what was spirit, eternal life, is no longer died, and now this is the after effects, and all the after effects are subject to death, you see. So spirit can show it to guilt and say, look, there's no more spirit, everything is subject to death, you see. So spirit must have died. So if we seek to gain the aliveness of the body, we will lose our life, suffer death. That will suffer death. But he who would set down his body for my sake, okay, set down his life. He would set down his life for my sake shall gain eternal life. So setting down your aliveness, he who would set down his aliveness for my sake, meaning you recognize, oh, I don't need this. This is a dream. I don't need anything to be subject to death. This is just a time trying to trick non-existent guilt. So when you recognize this, and you say, no, I've never been alive. So he would set down his life, I mean, say, I have never been alive. I've never been alive. What do you gain then? Eternal life. Eternal life. Eternal life. Eternal life is not aliveness. Aliveness is of the flesh, of the body. Eternal life, we cannot describe it. Except it's not subject to death. We can say that for sure. Absolutely. No aspect of eternal life is subject to death in any way whatsoever, nor to any vulnerability, decay, attack, you know. No, it's perfect. It's eternal life. So he who would seek his life here shall lose it, and he who sets his life aside for my sake shall have eternal life. Now we understand what Jesus is talking about. Turns out he's a perfect teacher. A lot of people don't understand that. So, I've never been alive. I've always been free. This is exactly what I've always wanted to be. Yeah. We are still exactly as God created us to be. So, I've never been alive. Say, yes, I know I've never been alive. Yes, I know I've never been alive. This is where I am now. So when we say, this is where I am now, it means with the awareness and acceptance of the statement we make. The assertion we make is, I have never been alive. And then we make full stop on the wow by saying, this is where I am now. This is where I am now. And this is an expression of full stop on the wow. I've never been alive. That's the assertion. Then this is where I am now is the full stop in the wow. This is where I am now. I've never been alive. This dream of aliveness is not, it's just a dream. It's not me at all. I've never been alive. This is where I am now. 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 I've never been alive. This is where I am now. So we are rolling this out, continuing the clarification. Obviously, those who have not prepared, as Jesus always said, you must prepare, 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 prepare for my return. Prepare, 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 prepare. Do not be like the foolish virgins who laugh and drink and waste their time and their lamps are empty. And then when it comes time, they say, oh my gosh, we don't have any oil in our lamps. You must wait. You must wait. He says, no, my return, the marriage is now. And they say, oh gosh, they run off to the marketplace and get some oil, come back, and the marriage doors are already closed. The door of the banquet hall is already closed. Too late. Too late. So, you know, it's this is the difficulty. Most of them in the world are not prepared. Can you just get them to pull themselves up by their bootstraps? And no, not really. Not really. What can be done? Full stop in the wow. There may be some that are not prepared, you see, but what can they do then? Get angry, upset? No. Just sit quietly and say, okay, wow. This is really amazing. I didn't think this would happen. So I didn't prepare because I didn't think it would happen. I didn't think Jesus was coming back. Remember, Jesus always says in the Bible, he says, you know, the parables are like someone leaves or someone goes, someone gives responsibility, like I'm going away, you know, but I'm coming to come back. And a lot of people end up, you know, the servants disbelieving and say, hey, wait a minute, he's never coming back. Probably he died somewhere. So let's take over let's take things over and do it our way. And let's not be faithful servants anymore. And then when Jesus comes back, they said, oh, okay, who's been a faithful servant? Who has taken good stewardship while I was gone? You know, and some will say, well, I did. And others will say, oh my gosh, you know, I didn't think you were coming back. So what to do if you have not prepared properly? What to do is to realize this. We'll say, wow, I didn't think Jesus was coming back. I mean, wow. So don't get angry at yourself or blame yourself or anything. It's simply you're astonished that he kept his word, he did come back. It means you were just simply, your advisor was mistaken, the voice of arrogance was mistaken, and cannot be trusted. Now you might get worried about that, say, well, I need a trusted advisor. Well, the Holy Spirit is a trustworthy advisor. And you say, yeah, but I did so wrong. Well, no, you just delayed. But delay doesn't hurt reality. It causes us to suffer, but you know, the truth is it doesn't hurt our reality, our true nature at all. So simply just say, wow. And all this that's happening right now, you just kind of take it in and say, wow, I got to learn from this now. So next time I won't be so foolish. I will prepare. Some may say, well, it's too late to prepare now, but I will begin preparing for the next opportunity as fast as possible here. This is the right way to make use of it. And then when you make use of it that way, you vastly shorten the time, your delay, vastly shorten it. If you miss an opportunity, this should bother you so much that you make sure you don't miss the next opportunity. So we let our belief system adjust to this, and in quiet, sitting quietly, is the greatest help. It's the very best practice of all. Sit quietly. So spirit looks at this universe and says, wow, I must have died. Here's all the evidence. But of course, deep down, spirit knows it's all a fake. But it wants to see how good of a fake it can make. So this is the world. The spirit wanted to find out, you know, how can I make the best fake possible? And this is the result. This is the handiwork of spirit. So we say, I've never been alive. I've always been free. I am exactly where I really want to be. I've never been alive. This is where I am now. I've never been alive. This is where I am now. I've never been alive. This is where I am now. I've never been alive. This is where I am now. Now, what's the result of that? Well, a significant, I would say. I always test out where I'm at in the spiritual path by imagining, well, what if Jesus walking down the street and there he was? You know, what am I going to say? How am I going to feel? Well, in the past, it's always been like, whoa, hey, don't get too close here. You know, there's always an edginess, like, not sure what the scary. But when we say this, I've never been alive, and we own it, and we say, I've never been alive. This is where I am now. This is where I am now. This is where my belief system, this is where my beliefs, this is where my focus is. I've never been alive. Never. None of this aliveness has anything to do with what I am. None of this aliveness has the slightest thing to do with what I am. Okay? So I have never been alive. This is where I am now. And I find now, when I say that, the fear of Jesus is dissipating, and it's like I say, yeah, okay, I understand what you're saying now. Because before he said, well, he would lose his life for my sake shall gain it, right? And he'd say, oh my gosh, he would try to keep his life, shall lose it, and he shall give up his life for my sake shall gain it. And I thought, oh, he's gonna ask me to give up my life, you know, or something. It's scary. But we didn't understand it. Now we do. So he's saying, he who would say, I have never been alive, shall gain awareness of eternal life. So I have never been alive. I have never been, yes, I have never been alive. This is where I am now. Yes, I have never been alive. This is where I am now. It's hard to stay conscious when you say this. You tend to start dropping into, you know, being more unconscious, so to speak. To bring this through here to this waking sleep is very difficult. I've never heard anybody say, I have never been alive. I have never been alive. But this is what we need to say. Jesus came back and he said, I'm here. I've come here to relate with you in friendship. Now, who wants to relate? That's it. There's no big speech. I think maybe people are expecting, you know, Jesus to come back and be on, you know, mainstream television and give a big speech. No. He just announced to the world spiritually, announced to our identity, said, I'm back. I'm back. I've come back to relate with you in friendship. Relate with you in friendship. That's it. So, who wants to relate? So this is a super crucial to get to this point is fantastic. We get to this point July 21st, 2:15. 15. Is it the 21st? Yeah, it is. Okay. 7:21. 2:15. 7 times 2 plus 1. 15. To get to this, I've never been alive and embrace it and accept it. This means it's success. It's success. Okay? I could say I've succeeded. I've succeeded. It doesn't bother me when I say I've never been alive. In fact, I say, well, that's great. And I say, yeah, that's it. I've never been alive. Repudiate this nonsense we call life. We call nature. Repudiate it. I've never been a child of nature. I've never been alive. I have never been alive. All this life and death has never happened to me. I've never had any of this happen to me, actually. It's all a dream, dream symptoms. So yes, we can do it. We absolutely can do this. So we need to try. This is my what I'm getting at, is what we need to do is make a great effort this last year now to relate with Jesus. And what's keeping us away from Jesus is this fear that he's going to ask us to give up our life. But what he really asks us is to recognize that we've never been alive. That's different than giving it up. If you have a dream and you dream of something, you know, you dream you go somewhere and you wake up and you say, well, I didn't go there. I didn't go there. I was just imagining it. So we never went into this world. I've never been born. I've never been alive. I've never been born. I've never been alive. This is where I am now. This is where I am now. Meaning in this realization, this is where I am now. So what can Jesus say more than that, that's more intense than that, to tell you to practice? Practice saying, I've never been alive. I have never been alive. I have never been alive. I have never been alive. You could say this is like, you know, one of the highest assertions. I have never been alive. Hallelujah, I've never been alive. This is where I am now. I've never been alive. I've always been free. This is what I've always really wanted to be. Aliveness is the booby prize. Completely. It's the dream state. It's an imaginary symptom. It's the dream symptom state. I've never been alive. I've always been free. I've never been entrapped in these cycles of nature. I've never been alive. I've always been free. I've never been alive. I've always been free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. Let's go, Jesus. Let's go, Jesus. Like that. So after the end of like a year's effort, we started, we wanted to be done by, we must fully accept this by this time next year. And we want to give ourselves a month grace period for sure. So by June 21st, 2016, we want to have accepted, at least accepted, feel like, yeah, I've never been alive. I've never been alive, and that's okay. I've never been alive, and that's okay. See, I never committed suicide. Spirit never committed suicide. Can't. It can't. It can't. How can it? It's created perfect as eternal life, perfect freedom. how can it commit suicide? It's always free to experience anything and everything at all. So how could it stop that? It cannot. So we imagine that it died, committed suicide by this world where we don't seem free. Nothing seems free here. It all seems to be bound up by these cycles of nature, right? All of it going towards what? Death. No more. It's no more. This is just a dream of spirit trying to convince, you know, non-existent guilt that the price has been paid. That spirit died. So, see, there's a very big difference between the non-dual truth and then dualistic deception. Dualistic deception will look at Jesus and say that Jesus, there is a price, guilt is real, there is a price to pay, but that Jesus paid it for us. See, this is what's called dualism. Manichaeism, Zoroastrianism, Manichaeism. And all the other dualistic labels, you know, various teachings, it's all dualistic. Jesus says, don't try to make illusions real and then escape them. That is the false way. So Jesus doesn't come back and say, hey, I paid the price. Guilt has been satisfied. It's been resolved. Guilt has been satisfied. Guilt, the death of a spirit has happened. And so now spirit can be happy. That's not what Jesus says at all. That's what everybody was hoping. That's what they're thinking. Dualistically, that's what you're going to think. But what Jesus really says is, hey, I was never alive. You've never been alive. Spirit has never been alive at all. And neither have we died. We've never been subjected to this aliveness at all. This is all just a dream. There is no guilt. We didn't change God. There is no guilt. This dream of aliveness is just imaginary symptoms. It has no effect on us. It doesn't touch us at all. There's no price that has to be paid. Nobody has to pay it. No, none of us have ever been alive. This is what Jesus says. This is the non-dual. This is the truth. So practicing this truth is all important. Instead of discussing, dialoguing, this, just practice. This is what people come up short on. No question about it. When in doubt, practice. Just say, hey, I've never been alive. I've always been free. And this is exactly where I have always wanted to be. You can say where or what. I've never been alive. I've always been free. And this is exactly where I've always wanted to be. Just in the freedom. See, in the freedom. No aliveness. I don't need aliveness. Aliveness is just a mouse for the cat of death to play with. That's all. The cat wants the mouse to stay alive for a while because it amuses the cat to play with it. You know, when the mouse dies, the cat's like looking, say, "What's? Come on, get up and play. Come on, come on, come on. I'm having a lot of fun here." And it gets upset and it's cranky when the mouse dies. It has fun playing with the mouse. So death is just playing with all this imaginary symptom we call death is just playing with all this stuff. But not really like a cat. But this gives you an idea that you know, the body is just a plaything of death. All this is just a plaything of death. It all ends up in impermanence, ends up in death. It's impermanent. The impermanence is just a trick, a dream we're dreaming, imagining, to try and trick guilt, to try to say non-existent guilt, but try to say this non-existent guilt. Hey, I paid the price. Okay, so now we're even. And the price has been settled, and that's it. It's now no longer an issue. Like if you have a debt, you pay the debt. You're free and clear of the debt. That's it. No more payments. So we're hoping that Jesus paid the price, and there's no more payments that we have to pay. Therefore, we won't have to keep dying. But that is not what has happened at all. Jesus said there isn't any price to pay. There isn't any guilt. No guilt, no price to pay. No need to keep this ridiculous charade of aliveness going, which is really just a dream of death. Now, of course, if Jesus saying this directly to the world 2,000 years ago, people wouldn't understood what he's talking about. So he did what he needed to do to at least kind of ring our bell a little bit, ring our bell, and we kind of say, whoa, what just happened? What just happened? I don't quite understand this, I thought he paid the price, but we're still dying, we have to believe, but it's still, I'm not sure, and I have to make up this and make up that, but that just doesn't really fit, and you kind of, it doesn't work, and then we get frustrated, and we need to dig deeper. And so Jesus is back now telling us the unvarnished, direct truth, that I've never been alive, I've always been free. This is us too. I've never been alive, I've always been free. This is just a dream, it hasn't touched me. I've never been alive, I've always been free. Nature is just a dream that has never touched me. I've never been alive, I've always been free. The universe is a dream that has never touched me. Right? So don't bother trying to find different exciting states of aliveness. This is just a mouse. The cat is all the while the cat is there, bringing about your death, the death, at least imaginary death. So don't worry about trying to, again, pursue all these different states of thrills, cheap thrills, states of aliveness, which is what everyone in the world is doing. You just look at it, it becomes obvious. Oh my gosh, they're zestfully running after this sort of aliveness or that sort of aliveness or that. And then occasionally they, have a bad fall and tears come and they get up and say, well, I gotta keep trying to find something good here with aliveness. It's way better, immeasurably better to simply say, I have never been alive. Assert this. I have never been alive. I have never been alive. And this is where I am now. This is where I am now. I have never been alive. This is where I am now. I've always been free. This is where I am now. I've never suffered. This is where I am now. I've never been sick. This is where I am now. I've always been at peace. This is where I am now. I've never been confused. This is where I am now. I have never been confused. I've always been at ease. This is where I am now. I've never been conflicted. This is where I am now. Make these absolute statements instead of chasing after some sort of frivolous aliveness. Like, oh, maybe if I wear this, this is the answer. Maybe if I get these stones, I wear these stones, this is the answer. Or maybe if I get stoned, that is the answer. None of that's the answer. Say, I have never been alive. I've always been free. This is where I really want to be. I've never been alive, I've always been free. This universe is a dream that has no effect upon me. I've never been alive, I've always been free. The universe is a dream of death that can never touch me. The universal dream can never touch me. Keep asserting that, keep asserting that, keep asserting that. Don't worry about figuring out or, explaining too much. Let the ones who already can see it, let them do the explaining. The practice comes, the more you practice it, the better it is. I'm able to do this because of a total lifetime dedicated to it. Otherwise, it's going to be more conceptual. Here, it's more of a felt, seeing conviction. It's an assertion. I'm really asserting it. I say, I've never been alive. I'm not thinking, what am I saying? I don't understand what I'm saying. No, I know what I'm saying. I've never been alive. I have never been alive. I've always been free. This universal dream has never even touched me. universal dream of death has never even touched me. I've never been alive, I've always been free. The dream of universal death has never touched me. I've never been alive, I've always been free. The dream of impermanence has never touched me. So, we're going a little further here than what most people are used to in terms of the teachings, spiritual teachings of the world, where we recognize the impermanence and all that, and that. But here, we're actually putting it all into context and explaining exactly why is there this dream of impermanence. Okay, everyone can note, oh, there's just impermanence. Some can say, see it's a dream, but they say, well, there's some adventitious situation, and somehow this dream came about, and, you know, whatever. No, it didn't somehow come about. It came about because, we've said here, but Spirit wanted to change the will of God to see if it was greater than God, try to prove it was greater than God. Couldn't do this. Failure. And instead of accepting this, Spirit said, no, I did change the will of God. In fact, you know, that God's destroyed. I mean, but the after effect of this, and the after effect, the proof of it, is this guilt. So the guilt becomes the proof that we changed the will of God. You see? This is what happened. So instead of saying, oh, I just failed, there is no evidence of success, so that's it, just drop it. Instead of doing that, we said, oh no, there's just guilt. This is the proof that I killed God. This is what Spirit says. But then we have this awful guilt, and we feel like that it's going to kill us, you know. So we say, wow, I got to get rid of this. So how do we do it? We fake our own death. We have this dream of impermanence that seems to indicate that Spirit has died, has committed suicide. And then we think that this will fool guilt, and the guilt will say, oh, okay, Spirit died. Now I'm okay. I got my revenge, and that's it. And then Spirit thinks that then it can somehow resurrect itself from this and say, aha, I'm now free of guilt. I killed God, I had the evidence called guilt, but I got rid of guilt too. Now I'm free and clear. This is where all of this dream of impermanence has come from. This is where what the whole context is. And this is the teachings of Jesus. I like the teachings of Jesus best of all because he gives this overall context, okay, which I don't find in the same way in anywhere else. Okay, not in just this very clear, you know, concise, no doubt about it way. And even if it is someplace else, it's also here. It's definitely here. You can say that it is definitely here. So if you want to go off other places and say, well, it's there too, well, you know, that's everyone's decision if they want to do that. But for me, why wander away from a sure thing? You know, why wander away from a sure thing? That doesn't make very much intelligence. It's not very intelligent. Take the sure way. Don't wander away from the sure thing. So we can easily say here, I've never been alive. I've always been free. The dream of universal impermanence has never touched me. Okay? Had a veggie dog for lunch. Morningstar hot dogs are very good. They taste just like hot dogs. Yeah, it's great. So you get need what? How many things you need for a good hot dog? 7 things. You need the bun. You need the hot dog. You need the mayonnaise. You need the pickle. And you need the mustard. Okay. What else? You need a plate. You need the eater. There you go. 7 things. That's it. So, hot dog bun, toast the hot dog bun, microwave the hot dog, mayonnaise, mustard, pickle in the bun, hot dog in the bun, plate, eater, boom, fantastic. Less is more with a hot dog. Less is more. This is what I've discovered as I've been eating hot dogs every day in the summer, July mood. It's time for hot dogs. And I found out that the more stuff you put in it, the bun gets all soggy and falls apart. You lose the taste of the hot dog. So it's better to I'm just going straight mustard with a slicer pickle in it. You know, one of those sandwich pickles that goes the length of the hot dog. Just the mayo, the mustard, the pickle, the hot dog. Boom. That's it. In the bun. And that is delicious. Absolutely delicious. Of course, put a lot of mustard on it. A lot of mustard. You can never have too much mustard on a hot dog, right? Never. You could probably sprinkle a little cheese on it if you want, but the best, I think, is that less is better. Less is more. Less is more. So, like a good American, I know I'm aficionado. I know how to produce the best kind of hot dog and hamburger. Expert at the hamburger too. How to slice the bun? Where to place the onion? Put the condiments down, and then you put the onion, which is in a circle, on top of that, and it holds the rings of the onion hold all the condiments in, so they don't spill all over the place. You see, that's how you do it. So, yeah, gotta know. Hot dogs and hamburgers. Of course, veggie burgers, which, since Morningstar came out with their veggie stuff, been able to eat hamburgers and hot dogs again. They're fabulous. I mean, the other stuff before was no good. All the veggie patties was not so good. Not so good. But whatever they did a fabulous job. I mean, I've had people eat the hamburger and they say, they thought it was meat. They can't even tell it's not meat. So, on a hot summer day, go for the hot dog, watch some baseball, and then say, I've never been alive. Just, you watch baseball, eat a hot dog, and drink some mango lemonade, which is an awesome drink. It really is. And just say, hey, I've never been alive. I've always been free. The dream of impermanence has never even touched me. The universal dream of impermanence has never touched me. Has never touched me. Has never touched me. I've never been alive. I've always been free. The dream of death can never touch me. The dream of death can never touch me. I've always been alive. I've never been alive. I've always been free. The dream of death can never touch me. Like that. And you just play with these assertions. You're sovereign over your own path, really, and just transpose them a little bit. If you're a musician, you know what I'm talking about, or you're a poetess or poet, and an artist, you know how to transpose and say, let me dip a little bit this way, a little bit this way. Or you're a cook, a chef, whatever. It's just like that. See, I've never been alive. I've always been free. The dream of death can never touch me. So, make a good hot dog, make a good assertion. Give it, usually simple is better. I was putting all sorts of stuff on that hot dog. I was putting, with everything I mentioned, then I was adding relish. I like just a straight pickle instead of the relish, because the relish gets kind of messy, too messy, but the pickle kind of helps hold everything together, just the slicer pickle, the long slice of a pickle, flat slice, stackers they call them sometimes. And so I was putting in the relish, I was putting in chopped onions, I was putting in grated cheese, I was putting in chopped up lettuce, I was putting green Tabasco sauce. All that stuff, it just like kind of the whole thing would like be falling apart and coming out the ends and the sides, and it just got way too messy. As far as eating a good hot dog, it's not, you don't want it to be too messy, because you have it in your hands, you just go chomp, 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 and maybe a little bit of mustard on your finger, and that's about it. But this, but put too much in, it's just falling all over the place. I think that's probably better for like tacos, if you eat tacos. I haven't eaten tacos in a long time, being a vegetarian. I don't know if they have good taco meat. Maybe you'll have to look into that. I used to eat tacos when I was young. It's great. That was for birthday. I say, what do you want? I say, tacos, my favorite food. Because I'd eat like about 10 of them. Fry them up there in the pan, and then throw all the stuff in the ground round, the lettuce, the onions, the salsa, the sour cream, the guacamole, the cheese, you name it, and just wrap it up. Wow, those were great. Yep. So The assertions are like that. Assertions are like a hamburger, the hot dog, the taco. You make it so it's good. It tastes just right. I've never been alive. I've always been free. And this is the place I've always wanted to be. Right? This is the place I've always wanted to be. This is how I've always wanted to be. This is where I am now. This is where I am now. This is where I am now. Let's go, Jesus. Yeah. This is where I am now. How are we doing here? Okay. It's recording. Everything's fine. This is where I am now. Which means you don't have to explain anything. You're just asserting, this is where I am now. Just remind yourself, this is where I am now. So, I've never been a body. Another way to say, I've never been a body. I've always been free. I'm still exactly spirit. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. This is where I am now. This is where I am now. I've never been alive. This is where I am now. I've never suffered. This is where I am now. I've never feared. This is where I am now. I've never been troubled. This is where I am now. I've never died. This is where I am now. I've never been alive. This is where I am now. So you might be saying, well, this isn't the teachings they taught back in Kansas, to use a Wizard of Oz analogy, and not trying to reference people of Kansas, but I'm just saying, hey, I don't think we're in Kansas anymore here. Right? Of course not. Because our fear twisted and distorted and changed and misinterpreted what Jesus was trying to, was telling us, and we have had a very difficult time to get it. Very difficult time. And I certainly have a very difficult time, and many are still struggling and not getting it, and they're waiting for Jesus and the archangels would come with flaming swords to wipe out their enemies, but Jesus is already back, and he just made a simple announcement. Just unassuming. So I'm walking down from the hills, mountains, came down from the mountains, the high mountains came down from there. And he said, okay, I'm back now, and I'm here to relate with all of you in friendship. So who wants to start relating in friendship? I said, okay, I will. I'll give it a try. Let me give it a try. Now, everyone's heard it. He announced it to the whole world, spiritually, right? Why should he announce it to bodies? I mean, to the flesh, to aliveness. He didn't announce it to aliveness. He announced it to eternal life. He said, hey, eternal life, I'm back in the world. I'm back in this dream that you're pretending that you committed suicide. And who's ready to relate with me through the truth, okay, that this is, all a fake. It's all a pretense. I've never been alive. I've always been free. The suffering of impermanence has never touched me. Okay, I've never been alive, I've always been free. The suffering of impermanence has never touched me. Has never touched me. Yes, this is true. So I'm a little more awake now. I was having trouble there with feeling desperately tired. As this, the shock of this hits, sometimes you can feel very tired. Don't go drink coffee. You just battle through it. And then you will catch a second wind and you're like, oh, great. And you'll still be calm. Whereas if you drink coffee, there's a problem there. And the chasing after all these experiences of aliveness, that's just more pretense, pretending that spirit's dead. Why would spirit be go chasing after experiences of aliveness like a mouse trying to escape a cat? You know, it's ridiculous. So that's just more of effort to sell this pretense, this deception to guilt. Again, we tried to change the will of God. It was impossible. Instead of accepting the feeling of it, that this is impossible, we said no, we did it, and the after effects is this guilt. So we invented guilt as an after effect, an effect of having killed God. We invented guilt. Oh, there's just guilt there that proves that we killed God. This guilt is our proof that we killed God, but it's imaginary. We imagined it. It didn't actually come from God at all. It's like an imaginary corpse, you know. There's no real corpse, but there's an imaginary corpse. We say, oh, see, there's the evidence. And yet we say, what do we do with this imaginary corpse? This is creeping us out, making us feel that we're going to die. Of course, we're one with God. And if there's evidence that God has died, we feel that we must have died too. So we have this terror, like, oh my gosh, this corpse is going to contaminate us and kill us. So we got to get rid of it, the corpse of guilt. So spirit pretended like it had died and made this dream of impermanence so that it can say, ah, you see, this proves I've died, and therefore the corpse of guilt is satisfied with this, and then the corpse now is, poof, it can vanish, and now I'm finally happy again. I can be happy once again. No longer threatened. I'm no longer threatened. We can say, I've never been threatened. I have never been threatened. I'm free. This is where I am now. I've never been threatened. This is where I am now. I have never been threatened. This is where I am now. So, this most excellent teaching always refers back to the very root, you see, of the situation and the overall context, which then really takes the fear out of it. It makes it easier and simpler and simpler and simpler. I mean, is Jesus going to say, hey, you know, if we relate to Jesus, says, okay, I want you to do the, you know, the triple special super dini asana and breathing exercise and go through the 10 mental states and the 6 avoidances, and then extrapolate from all those 10, you know, the 3 excellences, 3 levels of intensity, and da 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 da. No, it's not like that. It's not like that. Just assert, hey, I've never been alive. Just accept, I've never been alive. Oh, I've always been free. The dream of impermanence has never touched me. The misery of impermanence has never touched me. The fear of impermanence has never touched me. The suffering of impermanence has never touched me. Never, and this is where I am now. This is where I am now. The suffering of impermanence has never touched me, and this is where I am now. Okay? Just that simple. Jesus just wants us to practice the simple, simple, simple assertions. And then the full stop and the wow. We don't have to go through this vastly complex system of this and 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 endless philosophy and extrapolations and conceptualizations and all this stuff. No, just make a simple assertion. Accept it. Own it. All we have to do is own the situation. Okay? Don't say, oh, all this has just happened to me, but I can manipulate what is happening to me. This is duality. Duality is to say, well, all this is happening to poor little old me, but I can find a way to fight back, you know, and manipulate it. That's duality. Non-dual is to own it all and say, oh, yeah, I invented all this. I invented guilt. It doesn't exist. There is no corpse of God. And I invented this spiritual suicide to convince, to trick an imaginary a corpse that I invented so I could invent an imaginary freedom where I'm free of God and I'm happy. You know, I invented all of this. Just own it. That's all. Doesn't hurt to own it. Because then you realize, oh gosh, this is silly. I don't need to keep on with this nonsense. I can maintain for the sake of continuity. I can keep up appearances a little bit. Sure. That's not a problem. And that's it. See, it actually, the more simpler the practice is, the more powerful it is. Because you're really asserting how simple it all is, which it is. So the simple practice, you know, this is where I am now. I have never suffered. This is where I am now. you're also asserting tacitly that the whole situation is really just this simple. In other words, we all made it up. It's all made up. Whereas if we get real complex and stuff, that automatically tacitly is asserting that something has happened to me. It's very complex, something happened to me. If we just made it up, how could it be truly complex? All you have to do is realize, oh, this is just, I just made all this up. Where's the complexity there? It's not there. If you realize that you made it up, well, why is one worried about any complexity then? Oh, it's just an imaginary corpse. I mean, I just made up. Oh, okay. Why should I worry about a rotting corpse if I just imagined and made it up? It's not really there at all. You know, there's no snake, just a rope. I don't have to worry about how to get rid of the snake. It's just, I made it up. So, again, the power of a simple assertion is the unspoken assumption and assertion that it is simple. It is completely simple. This is why I say assertions are way better than dialogue. Okay, simple assertions are way, way better because there's a meta message in dialogue which is saying that it's complex. And then you say, oh, well, I couldn't have made it up then, really, because if I made it up, it couldn't be really complex because all I have to do is realize I made it up. So it must be maybe I made part of it up and the other part I didn't. I got to figure out how to use the part that I didn't make up to get rid of the part that I, you know, I got to use the part that I did make up to help me get rid of the part that I didn't make up. And so, in other words, then you're right back in, you know, right in duality, saying, okay, wow, there's something's happened to me, and I got to use all my efforts to figure out how to, you know, fight back and get rid of this. This is duality. And so you don't want to keep giving this meta message reinforcement through too much complexity. Always strive for simplicity. And the simplest of all is assertions, simple assertions, where you're not thinking in any dialogue back or forthness whatsoever. You're merely saying, I have never been alive. That's it. And you're just saying it, you're asserting it. You're not asking, you're not telling someone else, you're simply asserting it. I have never been alive. Self-evident truth, I have never been alive. And just accept it for yourself, that's it. You're not worrying about, I have to prove it to somebody else, because that's duality again. You think, well, there's part that I made up and there's part I didn't, and then I have to prove the part that I didn't that to leave me alone, you know. So simple assertions are the way to go. That's the whole point of the videos. Now, of course, we're so not used to that we need a little talk also. So I do a little filler. It's called flipping the script filler. That's fine. But I kind of keep it simple. You know, sometimes we talk about hot dogs, you know, right? Hamburgers. Lemonade. Speaking of lemonade, wow. Cherry limeade. That's pretty good, too. I love summer. It gives you a good excuse to ice cream and lemonade. Yeah, we can talk about that, but then go back to, hey, I've never been alive. I've always been free. The misery of impermanence has never touched me. This is where I am now. Thank you, Jesus. Why do we thank Jesus? Because he's the teacher that leads us to this simplicity, the simple approach. Of making assertions. We don't get caught up in overthinking it by saying, well, there's no one to assert here. So I don't make an assertion is a tacit assumption. There's someone to assert here, but there's no one to assert here. You know, that's outsmarting yourself. You know, that's being smarty pants, you know, trying to outsmart. That's not it. Of course, spirit is here to assert this. There is no I. Yeah, of course. The fact that there is no I doesn't mean there isn't any identity. Yeah, spirit, yeah, there's no spirit. Of course, spirit is here to say this. It's spirit that's making the assertion. There's never been an I. An I is a fake identity for this so-called death of spirit. Spirit had to say, well, that the corpse of its death has to be evident. Has to be evidence of where's the corpse. You know, well, there it is. There's an I that is now alive, subject to death, and you know, that's the evidence that spirit has died. So it's all fake. There isn't any I. There isn't any, you know, little self. There isn't any of that. But there is spirit that is faking all this. So the one who's faking all this has to say, hey, I've never been alive. I've always been free. The misery of impermanence has never touched me. I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. But same old, same old. When I was did piano teaching in a previous life, nobody wanted to practice, you know. I said, hey, wait, I spent my whole younger years practicing, you know, just either playing or practicing all the time, and a lot of practice. You can't do it without a lot of practice. So, you know, what are you talking about? And they say, no. We know you're a genius. You'll be able to show us how to do it without practice. And I say, no, I'm not. There's no such genius that can do that. And then they go looking for someone who can do that, you know, like, just inspire me. I know if you inspired me more, I could do it. You know, so they would say, come on, play better. I want to feel inspired. And then if I was inspired, I could just play like you. And I say, you know, that's just outsmarting yourself. You know, it's arrogance. This fundamental issue we have, you know, is so severe. We're so freaked out by it. We look at this universe and say, oh my God, maybe I did die. You know, spirit's saying, or how can I ever be resurrected? You know, why do we need to be resurrected if we've never been touched by this dream in the first place? So what's the point of resurrection? What do you mean? I never died. So how can I be resurrected? I don't need to struggle to be resurrected. I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. I've never died. I've always been free. The misery of impermanence has never touched me. I don't need to do anything except to recognize this is just all fake. I faked my own death. How can I be resurrected from a fake death? See, this is what the spirit's perplexed by. It's like, wait, how do I get resurrected? Well, just realize you don't need to keep dreaming a dream of fakery. That's all. You don't even need to change the dream. You just realize I don't need a dream at all. You can change the dream if you want. That's an intermediate step, death-free realm. Maybe in spirit, instead of faking its death, maybe it can fake its life. Let's work on faking life, so to speak, instead of faking death. Or is that the same thing? I don't know. That's where you get into. Then when you get into that, you say, okay, wait, let me just practice again. I have never been alive. I have never been alive. I have never been alive. Yeah, it's almost like we train ourselves that if we don't practice, that means we're smart. So I don't need to practice. I can figure it out. I'm smart enough to figure it out. This is a trap, isn't it? Who's smart enough to figure it out? The false I, see? The non-existent I is trying to enlighten the non-existent I, which simply perpetuates the notion that spirit has committed suicide. Why should spirit be trying to enlighten anything? It's everything. It's perfect. Spirit doesn't need enlightenment. So why is spirit trying to enlighten the I, you know, that there's just more of the pretension that spirit has committed suicide? So don't try to enlighten any I, just assert the truth. I've never been alive. I've never been an I. I've never had an I. I've never been alive. I've never had an I. The universal dream of death. It's, that ruins the rhyme, doesn't it? Has completely passed me, has always passed me by. I've never been alive. I've never had an I. Universal dream of impermanence has always passed me by. The misery of impermanence has always passed me by. I've never been alive. I've never had an I. I've never been an I. I've never been alive. I've never been an I. The miserable dream of impermanence has always passed me by. It's always passed me by. So, as much as possible, turn your dialogue and thinking, flipping the script, back into assertions. This is the practice. This is the genius of the practice. Because as you're thinking and trying to figure out, that's flipping the script. Okay, so you're always doing one of three things in your life. You're either asserting, you're either full stop in the wow, where you just need to take a break and just say, wow, this is just tremendous. Holy cow. I'm stunned by it. Or you're engaged in flipping the script. But try and bring the flipping of the script back into the assertions. This is the genius of the path. And this is what really produces the great acceleration, you know, to where the fear evaporates, the great evaporation. I've never been alive. I've never been a me. This is where I've always wanted to be. I've never been an I. I've never been a me. The misery of the dream of death. Has never happened to me. How do we say that? I've never been an I, I've never been me. This is where I really have always wanted to be. I've never been an I, I've never been a me, and this is where I've always really wanted to be. I've never been an I, I've never been a me, and this is where I've always really wanted to be. So use your will to turn your dialogue and your thinking and flipping the scriptness back into assertion. It's kind of like a musician where they'll be like dreaming, thinking like, yeah, it'd be great if I did a song like this, okay, did a song like this. You know how that is. If you're a musician, you hear a song in your head, oh, I think I could, like, this would be great. But what if all you did was do that and you never actually, you know, put your hands on the piano or guitar or whatever and started actually doing the chords and figure it out, right? I mean, what's that? You could never play the song, just in your head. So the same way the spiritual practice is, you have to use flipping the script to get back to assertions. I've never been an I, I've never been a me, and this is where I really have always wanted to be. I've never been an I, I've never been me. This is where I've always really wanted to be. In this realization, right? I've never been an I. I've never been a me. This is where I really have always wanted to be. I've never been an I. I've never been a me. And this is where I really have always wanted to be. This is where I've really always wanted to be. I've never been an I. I've never been a me. I've never been alive. I've never been a me. And this is where I've always really wanted to be. I've never been miserable. I've never been a me. And this is where I always really wanted to be. I've never been, I've never ever suffered. I've never been a me. And this is where I really always wanted to be. And this is what produces the wow. This is what produces the wow, is these assertions. Because again, the underlying assumption is it really is just as simple. The very fact that you're insisting on doing just this simplicity is, you're really stating, I know it's really this simple. And this is what really brings about the wow, shock of the wow. And then, of course, you can talk it away, which is why I say full stop in the wow. Or simple flipping of the script. So you feel, you know, the depth of the shock. It's like, wow, this is really deep. This shock goes very, very deep. Now I gotta get stuff going. I have responsibilities. I have things. I have role to play. Responsibilities to take care of here. So, you know, I gotta keep pushing. There are those who, you know, relying on me to succeed at what I'm doing, play my role, so to speak. And so I have got to get that going. Now we've got a year, a little less than a year now, but to use our will to turn our thinking and thoughts and dialogue and all this back into simple assertions, and then practice those simple assertions, then sit quietly and full stop in the wow. As we do this, this will be you know, super effective. However effective it is in the short term, it puts us back on track. It puts us back on track. Now, the world is, well, we don't need to talk about the world, right? It's never touched us. So the dream of impermanence has never touched me. I've never been alive. I've always been free. The dream of impermanence has never touched me. This is the truth. The same way a dream doesn't really touch the dreamer. I mean, we can quibble about it, but the principle is the same, right? The dream, the dreamer is going off here and is drowning in this lotion and doing this. And the dreamer wakes up and says, oh, I'm fine. I wasn't really touched by that at all. It seemed very real. I was dreaming, but I wasn't touched by it. So we have to keep asserting that I'm not touched by this. I've never been alive. I've always been free. This dream, this miserable dream of impermanence has never, ever even touched me. This is where I am now. This is where I am now. This is where I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. Here is great. Every effort is important. Don't have much work now, hardly any work at all. It's terrible. So I have to do something to make ends meet. And so I'll keep working and rolling out, talking about Jesus, trying to roll it out. I know it's too much for most people. Of course, I don't know how to, you know, bridge this gap, because everybody has their own ideas about Jesus. Everybody, right? There's this, and there's this, and there's this, and this. But I'm trying to bring the perspective of Jesus as you know, an ultimate teacher, super teacher. You know, you're not going to find a better teacher, right? You might say, well, you can find one just as good, but why walk away from a sure thing? You know, that kind of question, you know, but Jesus is a super teacher. One moment here, let's see if I have to take this or not. No, I won't. I will just, why walk away from a sure thing? So I'm just presenting Jesus as a super wise teacher who knows that these simple assertions, with the underlying meta message that it really is simple, we just made it all up. There is no corpse of God, this guilt, evidence of our guilt. You know, there isn't any such guilty corpse at all. We made it up. Therefore, we don't need to try and get rid of it. So we don't need to make up our pretend suicide here, which means we don't have to keep believing that any of this really touches us at all. All this dream symptoms don't touch us at all. We don't have to keep believing that. And we can realize I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I've always been happy. I've always been blissful. I've always been free. The, you know, the misery of impermanence has never touched me. I've always been blissful. I've always been free. And this is what I really have always wanted to be. Right? I've always been blissful. I've always been free. This is where I really have always wanted to be. So, we're going to keep this under, you know, about an hour and a half or so, instead of the 2.5. I know people are under a lot of stress right now, for sure. Believe me, stuff is happening. People I know, relatives, a lot of stuff. People are having very bad problems, very breakdowns, this and this and that, and all sorts of stuff is happening. It's the time of, you know, people are getting in their own way. You know, this is a time where if we haven't figured out how to get out of our own way, we're going to end up tripping on ourselves, so to speak. So these assertions help us get out of our own way. This is what is so important, to get out of our own way. Get out of our own way. I've always been blissful. I've always been free. this is where I've always really wanted to be. And this is where I've always really wanted to be. Okay, this is where I am now. 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 So if you meet Jesus, instead of getting defensive and saying, oh, co-opt the whole situation in the right way and just say, hey, Jesus, I've never been alive. Welcome back. I've never been alive. And just start with that opener. You know, hey, nice to meet you. I've never been alive. How about you? Hello. I've never been alive. I've never been here. I've never experienced the misery of impermanence. I've always been totally blissful. I've never been sick. I've never died, I've never been born, I've never been alive. Never even been alive. How can I experience all this misery and suffering if I've never even been alive? Right? I've never been alive. And Jesus would say, wonderful, I have never been alive either. Nice to meet you. Or, great to see you again, actually. Great to see you. Great to, great that we're friends are together again, you know. Like that. Oh, you're not alive? Great, you've never been alive. It's not that I'm not alive. I've never been alive. Like, how can I speak of no longer alive? I can't even say that. I've never been alive. Jesus says, that's great. I haven't either. And the truth is, neither has anyone else. So we've just been trying to pretending to fool this corpse of guilt, which we made up, doesn't exist. We're trying to placate this boogeyman that we invented, and doesn't exist. So we don't really need to placate it, do we? We just realize it's a boogeyman that doesn't exist. All right. So very great. I got to keep on keeping on here, and you too. And see, you know, how, if we can keep going big, see, every day, see if you can go really big in that day. That's what I'm trying to do. Do something I've never done before, you know, the day before. I mean, it's going to go really big today. And just, wow, like, oh my gosh, I'm going really fast now. That kind of thing. Just keep doing that. Make that your objective. Today, I'm going to double the speed, you know, or do some, you know, just really go big. All right. Very great. I'm going to bring this wonderful video to an end. It's been a very good one. And it helped us go big, and let's keep doing that. Okay, very great. That's it.